Cranberry Sauce, an examination of the Paul is Dead hoax.
Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock as the day begins.
He blew his mind out in a car.
When I caught a glimpse of Rita, took her home, I nearly made it.
He didn't notice that the lights had changed.
You were in a car crash, and you lost your head.
Crowd of people stood and stared. They'd seen his face before.
My friends have lost their way. We'll be over soon, they say. Now they've lost themselves instead.
Celebrities can be viewed as being bigger than life, and in particular the rock superstar has often been viewed upon as being godlike, with legions of followers that hang on their words like it was commandments handed to the masses from voices on high. The rock gods, if you will, take on mythic proportions, and legends build on their names. Like all legends and myths, stories of these idols of worship can take on lives of their own. And as with such tales, there are many different views and interpretations of what it all means, and questions about what it is all about after all. In all of pop and rock history, perhaps there were none so idolized as the Beatles. Their music and fashion influenced and defined a generation, and their impact continues to be felt nearly 50 years after they first commanded the world's attention. And much of the story and meanings of the songs of the Fab Four, as they were commonly referred to, still remain shrouded in mystery, with fans old and new trying to decipher the truth behind the myths. Perhaps the biggest mystery of all involving the Beatles is the story of how one supposedly died back in 1966. Paul McCartney. Details vary on what exactly happened, as indeed much of the details in this legend differ depending on the source that tells the tale.
How did Paul die?
During the early morning sessions for Sgt. Pepper.
On Stupid Bloody Tuesday, November 8, 1966.
Paul stormed out of the studios, mad at the others.
Depressed after an all-night, not-too-successful recording session.
And after taking a few drinks, proceeded to drive off into the night.
He was out alone in his Aston Martin.
Some believe he picked up a hitchhiker named Rita, who, after recognizing her famous driver, jumped all over him, causing the accident.
He crashed and was decapitated.
He blew his mind out in a car.
He was officially pronounced dead.
Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock as the day begins.
On November
9.
Wednesday morning papers didn't come.
Subsequently, the theory continues, a Paul McCartney look-alike contest was held. The winner was spirited away for minor plastic surgery.
William Campbell from Scotland has not been heard from since allegedly winning the contest, and in fact could be the person we know as Paul today.
What is agreed upon is that the Beatles supposedly decided to cover up McCartney's untimely death by replacing him with a lookalike and placing clues for fans to discover on their albums that would reveal the truth in cryptic ways.
Sergeant Pepper's visuals are very obvious.
The front cover was a gem of a find. One sees the four Beatles all holding instruments which are inappropriate to them. But of the four, only Paul is holding a wooden or coffin instrument. It's also black for death.
All the Beatles are wearing mustaches. Possibly, Paul's covering a scar that we've seen in many pictures of Paul McCartney.
There's a mass of people gathered around the Beatles. Twin sets of Beatles, by the way. One in ornate costume in the central part of the picture, and the other set in black clothing. And two of them smile while the other two, Paul and especially Ringo, look into the grave in postures of grief.
There's a grave on the front, which they have acknowledged to be some sort of a grave.
Obviously, a Beatles grave.
Seen with the word Beatles being spelled out in flowers, red hyacinth, the mythological flower of death.
Done in the lower right-hand corner is a group of flowers in the shape of a left-handed bass guitar, which if looked at in a certain way, you know, also spell out Paul, question mark.
Or if one looks sideways, the yellow flower resembles a P for Paul.
Why is left-handed significant as to the
Paul's
bass guitar?
Left-handed.
Is he the only left-handed Beatle?
Yeah, that's right.
You also have an open palm hand over the Beatle Paul McCartney. That is an Eastern symbol of death.
That's a symbol that seems to recur a lot in a lot of the albums.
The owner of this hand, who is staring at Paul, is the writer Stephen Crane, most famous for his war story, The Red Badge of Courage. Mr. Crane himself died when he was 28 years old. Another of Mr. Crane's short stories is called The Open Boat and concerns four men who struggle to survive in a lifeboat. The one most determined to keep the group together dies in the ordeal. The other three, then, act as interpreters of the event. Other famous but dead people looking at Paul include Edgar Allan Poe, himself dying a tragic death, Marilyn Monroe, a suicide victim, and the other dead Beatle, Stu Sutcliffe.
Right-hand side of the album, you see a doll.
Seated in the lap of a deathly figure who is wearing a blood-stained driving gloves.
You also see the doll holding a car in her right hand.
Possibly representing Paul's white Aston Martin, which he was driving on that fateful night.
If you take a look at that car very closely, you'll see that car is filled with red ink, which possibly could be construed as blood.
In the center of the cover is a bass drum.
Peter Blake had designed the entire cover for Sgt. Pepper's. However, he did not design the drum skin. And the drum skin was designed by a painter whose name was given as Joe Epgrave. Now, if you take the name Ep and Grave and put it together, it sounds suspiciously like Epitaph and Grave. You also notice that the phrase Lonely Hearts is in different lettering. And if you'll notice in the crowd, you have Lewis Carroll standing there, who was one of John Lennon's favorite authors, who he enjoyed the wordplay. And if you remember, Lewis Carroll wrote Alice's Adventures Through the Looking Glass.
Now, take a mirror and place the edge of the mirror at right angles to the front of the cover. And line the mirror up so it exactly cuts the words Lonely Hearts in half and reflects the top half of those letters back in the mirror.
And what you'll see is the number one, then you'll see the word O-N-E, then you'll see another number one, then you'll see an X. So what it now says is 111X, because one Beatle's been X'd out. Then it says H-E. Then there's a little arrow point. Then it says D-I-E.
He died. And between he and die is a diamond-shaped arrow that points straight up to Paul and down to the grave. And as you look at this, the two ones together, at first you may think, well, maybe the one with nine letters, he died. But the two ones placed together form 11-9, which would have been November 9th. Clues in a number of books that suggested that Paul actually had an automobile accident on November 9th, 1966. If you consult your calendar, November 9th, 1966 was a Wednesday.
Open up the album.
Inside the cover of the Sgt. Pepper album, Paul alone has his legs drawn up as a child in the womb. Now that really says a lot, right? It signals rebirth. That's what the Cloosters say.
He also wears a decoration in the center of his tunic that's awarded by the British Army for heroic death. And as you might suspect, it is always awarded posthumously. This decoration is not to be confused with the Order of the British Empire that he wears on his lower left breast.
But the real clincher theorist felt was on his left arm. Paul is wearing a patch which reads,
O-T-D.
Now, in Great Britain, OPD is like our DOA. It stands for Officially Pronounced Dead.
There's only one problem. The patch that he's wearing doesn't say OPD. It says OPP, as in Ontario Provincial Police, which is what the patch stands for.
The one hole that I always felt there was in the theory was the OPD thing, and I knew that coming from the United States, as the whole program originally did, that you may not have known that OPP was in fact an Ontario Provincial Police, and that the crest that is on his sleeve is in actual fact an OPP police crest. And I spoke to you this afternoon about that, and we got out the Sgt. Pepper album, you and I, together.
Yes.
And suddenly I realized that in fact the last P on the crest looks as though it has been doctored.
Yes.
It doesn't look like a crease in the clothing, as my eye had originally thought. It's phenomenal, either the consequence of it all, or indeed the satanic thinking that was going on within a group of four Beatles who we would have never suspected.
I could never possibly think that all that is coincidental.
Go to the back of the album. You'll see the four Beatles. Three of the Beatles are facing the camera. The one that is not is the Beatle Paul McCartney. His back's to us. And the songs Within You, Without You are on his back.
Notice also that the braids on the other three Beatles are now on their left sides, whereas on the front the braids are on their right. These braids had consciously been changed, as wearing them on the left side is part of the military funeral dress code in England.
George Harrison is making a gesture as if pointing, and it looks like he's pointing directly to that line about Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock.
This is the time that theorists say Paul was OPD, officially pronounced dead, after his tragic accident during the night. Other lyrics in the Sgt. Pepper album point out some very strong specifics.
The most obvious references are in A Day in the Life, where the lyrics say, he blew his mind out in a car. He didn't notice that the lights had changed.
And the suspicion is that he was in fact killed in an automobile accident. Yeah. Is that right?
The name Billy Shears is interesting. It was rumored in 1969 that Billy Shears was the name of a band leader in England, and that when he died in 1947, he said he would be resurrected in 20 years. Also, it should be pointed out that if the name Billy Shears is broken up, it could read Billy's Here. The song refers, though, to Billy Campbell.
Getting so much better all the time.
A final mystery on this album appears on the English pressings on the Parlophone label. At the very end of side two, right up along the label, is another groove. If you have a manual turntable, which doesn't automatically shut off at this point, one can make out some voices reciting a short group of words. While the exact meaning varies according to different people, some have interpreted this groove to be saying such things as Lucy Abbey all the way, or He's found heaven, just see what you want to see, or Inshallah never. We'll play it twice more. What do you think it says? Radio station WKBW in Buffalo, New York, played this groove backwards and suggested it says, we'll all be back here soon. Let's try it three times. Let's see what you think it says. That it exists at all as an indication of the lengths the Beatles would go to try and hide messages in their albums.
Then comes Magical Mystery Tour.
Even the title of that album suggests the motor vehicle theme, a theme which crops up again and again in the Beatles' work.
It's a study of visuals containing most of the message songs. First, the gigantic clue to a Beatle mystery. The front cover shows three white animals, and in the foreground, arms spread in crucifixion fashion, we find to be a walrus, who later we find out to be Paul.
Now, there's a lot of speculation that the walrus is a symbol of death in Roman mythology, in Dutch mythology, in Eskimo and mythology. So that would be significant.
If the tour album cover is held up to a mirror, the phone number 836-7132 appears where it reads Beatles.
According to how you hold the cover, whether upside down or not, these three phone numbers are agreed on as appearing. 834-1735, 483-5317, and 237-7038.
And that on the back of the Sgt. Pepper album, George points to Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock. Now, one girl making the obvious connection between these two albums called this number at the time indicated and asked for, of all people, Billy Shears. And a voice replied, "You're getting hot, Jack." She couldn't answer the strange questions asked of her, so she called back the following week to find that the phone was disconnected.
It was rumored that, one, you would get a funeral parlor, or two, you would get an angry old lady whom you'd have awakened from her sleep at 3 a.m., or three, the strangest story of all, as reported in a Washington, D.C. underground paper and simultaneously in a rumor sheet circulating through the music business in New York, was that you'd get someone answering the phone who would claim to be Billy Shears. After quizzing the caller on Beatle trivia, he would promise to send you tickets to Pepperland. It was reported that three Michigan students received such tickets in the mail with the inscription ADN on the envelope. Apparently, the stamps on the envelope, which the receiver was instructed to lick, were laced with LSD, because one of the Michigan students did lick them and jumped from the window as to his death. The second student claimed to have already been to Pepperland in the Caribbean Sea and was returning there on the upcoming November 27th. The third student, when queried, just laughed. By the way, if you call these numbers today, they're all out of service.
The title song of the album suggests that everyone come along for the magical bus ride.
Thought by some to suggest the ambulance that took Paul's body away from the scene of the accident and inevitably to his final resting place.
In a scene from the film Magical Mystery Tour, John Lennon and George Harrison watched the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band perform at a striptease club. This only scene is called Death Cab for Cutie. Paul McCartney was often referred to as the Cute Beatle.
In another scene from the film, during the music video of George Harrison's Blue Jay Way, there is a segment where we see three Beatles watching something on a film projector screen. A headless torso with the words Magical Mystical Boy written on its chest.
In Blue Jay Way, the Cloosters point out, this is on Magical Mystery Tour, that there is a lyric that says, "Please God, please find me, please find my body."
And this is backward on Blue Jay Way.
Find me my body, oh God. Find me my body. The reversal of Blue Jay Way.
The inference here is what? Find me my body?
God, please, or please, God, please, find my body.
Or find me my body, find my body. Please, God, please, find my body.
It's like a soul, you know. It's
find me.
It's now a what? Chant. The resurrection, you know, man.
Please save me now.
This is backwards. Your mother should know. Dead, why doesn't she know me? I shed the light. Why doesn't she know me? Dead. Why doesn't she know me? I shed the light. Why doesn't she know me? Dead. I shed the light. Why don't they ask my mind? I don't know. Why doesn't she know more if I shed the light?
In I Am the Walrus, phrases from King Lear are heard at the end. Things like untimely death, bury my body.
Bury my body. And give the letters which thou find'st about me to Edmund, Earl of Gloucester. Seek him out upon the British party. Oh, untimely death. Death.
And he'll be well. A serviceable villain. As duteous to the vices of thy mistress as badness would desire.
What? Is he dead?
Sit you down, father. Rest.
Why is a death scene from a Shakespearean play being read into a Beatles song?
In the inserts inside the album here, in the picture book sort of thing, it says, I am the walrus. No, you're not, said little Nicola.
Relate the words to a car crash. I'm crying, waiting for the van, that is, the ambulance, to come. Stupid, bloody Tuesday. I am the Eggman. Easter eggs? Resurrection? I am the walrus, symbol of death in the low countries of Europe. Gugu-kuchoo, a phrase spoken in Finnegan's Wake, upon the attainment of a state of cosmic consciousness, of unity with the universe. In other words, attainment of death.
Strawberry Fields. You'll hear at the end of Strawberry Fields, at normal speed, I buried Paul.
The album Magical Mystery Tour includes a full-color 24-page booklet that's filled to bursting with clues.
Go to page 3. That is a picture of two soldiers. One happens to be the Beatle Paul McCartney sitting behind a desk.
On the desk is the sign, I was you, or I was.
And if you look over his head, you see a flag being draped, as you would, of course, on a coffin.
A lip scar is more evident in this picture.
Go to page 5, you see what could possibly be thought of as a giant tombstone. You also see 4 policemen standing on top of that tombstone. You also see about a dozen surgeons standing in front of what could be thought of as a tombstone.
A white piano is an operating table.
Next to a white piano, he's barefoot on page 10, and there's a hand behind Paul's head, of course. And on page 13, he's standing barefoot with his shoes over next to the drums.
Paul's blood-stained shoes stand before the drums.
Page 6 has 2 large pictures. The top shows a man with a walrus mustache chuckling his way past a tour window, which boasts the best way to go is by MD Company.
Page 21 puts George Harrison in the center of a street. Page 23 smacks with a heavy clue.
You will see at the bottom of the staircase the 4 Beatles. 3 of the Beatles that are not part of this investigation, have red roses on. Again, the Beatle Paul McCartney is being singled out for something, because he has a black rose on.
What significance do you attach to that?
Black rose obviously symbolizes death.
Do you know how rare black carnations are? Not likely that one would be found lying around.
A group shot on page 24 brings back what other group shots have shown. Paul with his arms raised with a hand over the head.
The old Eastern symbol of death over his head again.
The next album to be released was the White Album.
The double set, The Beatles. The simplicity of the White Beatles album
visually is rectified with heavy engineering and audio secrets. The inserts let you draw plenty of conclusions. Although Paul appears to be taking an unassuming bath, his head is floating in shampoo. Now, at first glance, that's all it may seem to be. Look again. This may well indicate a brain splatter.
On the collage inside, on the back of which are the lyrics, people are saying that passport photo is not Paul, but the guy who has replaced him, and that was a picture of a William Campbell, who was the winner of the lookalike contest.
A key song in the whole Paul is Dead mystery is Glass Onion,
which deals in large part with the thematic material of earlier Beatles songs.
John Lennon sings about, "I told you about strawberry fields." Well, here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul.
I told you about the walrus and me, man. You know that we're as close as can be, man. Well, here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul.
Here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul.
There's a song titled, "I'm So Tired." And at the end of the track, as the music ends, someone speaks a gibberish phrase. Now the clue is supposed to come out when you take the gibberish phrase and play it backward. What the voice is saying is, "Paul is dead now. Miss him, miss him, miss him."
Every time I hear that, I still get chills up my back, because that was one clue that just, well, literally it frightened us, because it is such a bizarre clue that is part of this whole investigation.
What confused me, though, was the fact that when the record is played forward, despite the fact that that phrase is gibberish, it is definitely a man speaking, and not some kind of a tape trick. How come, then, when you reverse the tape, a semi-intelligible phrase emerges? So, here's my original contribution to the Paul McCartney controversy, an experiment. Very carefully, into a tape recorder, I spoke this phrase: "Paul is dead now. Miss him, miss him, miss him." Then, I took that tape and turned it backward so that it sounded like this.
Miss him, miss him, miss him, one dead zero.
Then I rigged up another tape recorder and microphone and a set of earphones. And then, playing the tape of myself backward, I tried to mimic that sound so that I was actually speaking the backward phrase.
Miss him, miss him, miss him, why, that's it all.
Then, after I'd practiced a few times, I tried saying the phrase backward without listening to the original tape.
Sim, miss him, miss him, why, that's it all.
Please excuse the embarrassed tone in my voice there, wouldn't you be? Anyway, I finally took that tape of me speaking the forward phrase backward and turned it backward. And this is what happened.
Oh, he's dead now. Miss him, miss him, miss him.
Which is very close, of course, to... Now, does that prove anything to you? It did to me, and I got terribly excited about it at the time, but I can't really remember what it was.
More interesting aspects of the White Album is a short little song that appears on the record right before Revolution No. 9. It does not appear in the list of song titles, nor do its lyrics appear on the lyric sheet.
Can you take me back where I came from? Can you take me back?
These allegorical lines lead into the selection which convinces many people the Paul is Dead rumor to be something thought of more than just a series of coincidences. The track is Revolution No. 9.
It isn't always necessary to hear lyrics of the Beatles' music in a forward motion.
Number nine
was the first big clue. Only difference is you split channels and you play things backwards. And you get this.
Tens of thousands of people will tell you, quite seriously, that the phrase is "turn me on, dead man," spoken over and again.
Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man.
I want to point out to you something. If you were to say number nine, number nine, number nine, and reverse the tape, you would not get Turn Me On, Dead Man. Now Underman, now Underman, now Underman. It's the way they stress the words. Number nine, number nine, number nine, which gives you the illusion of Turn Me On, Dead Man. Neanderman, Neanderman, Neanderman.
This is a long collage of sounds, of snatches of conversation, of fragments of music, and the tapes are all mixed as a montage, apparently in a random pattern, and on first hearing, unintelligible. The total feeling of the work comes close to that of musique concrète.
So here was a recording which was always going to have a very rich bounty for anybody looking for supposed clues. Not only if you played it forwards, but especially if you played it backwards.
And someone finally discovered that if you play the right channel of the stereo alone, all kinds of things happen that are masked in the two-channel version. First, you can hear a voice talking about hitting a light pole and getting to a surgeon.
Go to the light pole, and we better go to see a surgeon.
From there, Revolution 9 drifts into a full stream of consciousness Freudo-Joycean montage, and it is very, very easy to hear in it the kind of splintered and pain-racked thought flashes that might be going on in the brain of a musician who has been badly hurt in an automobile accident. My wings are broken, and there are flames.
Continuing frontwards on the cut, many strange sounds can be heard, including car horns, a car crash, and fire burning. Must have got it in the shoulder blades.
There is absolution, sacraments, final rites.
Take this, brother. May it serve you well.
There are the voices of women. There is music and a remembered football game. Hold that line. Live. Live. But then there is the final fade out, and there is death.
When this song is played totally in reverse, more interesting phrases can be heard besides the famous Turn Me On, Dead Man. While the crashes, screams, and fire can still be heard, after about 1 minute and 10 seconds, a faint "Let me out" can be heard, apparently from someone burning in a car. At 2 minutes and 30 seconds, the fire sounds are very clear, and we hear the phrase, "There were two. There are none now." Paul and Rita. At 5 minutes and 35 seconds, we hear someone screaming, "Let me out. Let me out."
Assuming for a moment that there was a car accident, someone screaming, "Get me out," would be a very logical piece to listen to. The next piece is bizarre, and this is where we start to electronically change things a little bit. This is right off of number nine, and there's a baby crying, and someone's saying over it, "Who's to know?" This is at normal speed.
Who's to know? Who's to know?
Now that is, again, what it sounds like at normal speed. What we did is we slowed down the "who's to know" to, I'd say, approximately half the normal speed. And if you accept the hypothesis that there was a car accident, tell me if this doesn't sound like a man groaning to get out of it.
Now let's talk about the Yellow Submarine album for a moment, okay? The Clue Freaks found something really significant on the cover of Yellow Submarine. John Lennon is holding his hand up and making the symbol for horns behind Paul McCartney's head. That means Paul's dead, without a doubt, right? John is already beginning to show up as a very spiritual individual. And we all know that it is common for spiritual figures to raise their right hands with some sort of mystical symbol.
All together now,
all together now,
all together now,
all together now,
all together now.
I'm
a
legs
ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm a legs ball, I'm
four Beatles are crossing a street called Abbey Road.
It's fairly obvious we're looking at a parade.
It can almost be thought of as a funeral procession.
And they are leaving what appears to be a cemetery on the left-hand side of the album cover.
You have Lennon in the front.
He's dressed in white and with long hair, looks either like a doctor or a minister or even
a white Jesus Christ.
Perhaps the parishioner, if you will.
The next man walking across the street is Ringo, who's dressed as an undertaker.
Dressed very much like a mortician.
A black-suited minister.
The next man is Paul, who's wearing an outdated suit.
An obvious corpse.
He is also the only Beatle without shoes.
People are buried in England without their shoes.
That's true. That's so I understand, yes.
He is also the only Beatle out of step.
Holding a cigarette in his right hand. Paul is left-handed.
The final person in the back there is Harrison.
Wearing denim clothes like he's a grave digger.
The obvious BW is on the left-hand side of the album cover. On the license plate, 28IF.
28IF.
And if Paul McCartney were alive today, he would be in his 28th year of existence.
You're wrong, you may be thinking, regarding Paul's being 28 if he were alive in the fall of 69. It has been pointed out that he would have been only 27. But he would have been in his 28th year of existence. And by Indian belief, would be 28, as one's first year as a fetus is counted as part of one's life. And the Beatles made no secret of their fascination with Indian beliefs.
A police hearse decorates the right-hand side on Abbey Road.
Reverse the album and tell me whether or not you find anything on the rear of the album that to you is suspicious or appears to be deliberate.
It's a perfectly clear photo of this wall, except there is this girl in blue walking through the picture. The girl's elbow, if you hold the album about an arm's length away from your face, you see the lower profile of Paul McCartney's face really embedded in the girl's elbow. You see his nose, and then you see his lips right where her elbow joint should be. So you have a hidden, ghostly image of Paul on top of this girl in blue.
The name Beatles has a crack running through it on the S, making the name imperfect.
If you also connect the dots directly in front of Beatles, you get three Beatles.
If you turn the album sideways, look after the word Beatles, you see some shadows. It's actually the head of a ghost. You see the two eye sockets and the place for the nose.
Songs on the Abbey Road LP also held some revelations.
In the first cut, called Come Together, the themes of death and resurrection are unmistakable.
Come Together describes a person having hair down to his knees. After dying, a person continues to have nail and hair growth, since hair and nails contain protein which continues to grow.
One and one and one is three.
That one and one and one makes three line could apply to the triune Christian God or to the three remaining Beatles.
The song continues, he wear no shoeshine, a barefoot person like Paul on the Abbey Road cover. He played toe jam football, rugby, which Paul played quite well. He got monkey finger, skinny and bony like a skeleton. Also, I know you, you know me, come together. The song Sun King draws its title from historical literature. The Sun King was a name given to Louis XIV of France. This powerful monarch was the subject of Alexandre Dumas' Man in the Iron Mask, a piece of historical fiction about a twin brother of Louis who was sentenced to wear an iron mask to prevent his public identification. However, the twin ended up replacing the real Louis without anyone but his closest associates knowing about the switch. The whole scenario resembles the theory of Paul being replaced and the change being covered up.
The finale of the album includes three songs which run into one another. Besides being some of the most brilliant and tight playing in their careers, the Beatles suggest several things from the titles. Golden Slumbers, A Long Sleep, Carry That Weight, A Corpse-Filled Coffin, and The End. No explanation needed.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All good children go to heaven.
The final album of new Beatle material was Let It Be. The title itself suggests that perhaps the search for clues and hidden meanings should stop when all should just let it be. But due to the nature of the very album itself, it's very difficult. To begin with, it's the only Beatle LP framed in black. All four Beatles are on the cover, but only Paul's picture has a blood-red background. The others are white.
Let it be, let it be, let it be, even at
I was wondering if, like, last year we had a big thing about Paul McCartney being dead.
Yeah.
And I was wondering how much of it was planned and how much was planned by you.
It had nothing to do with me. The first, there is a rumor that he is dead, actually, but the first I heard about it was in the press, you know. I don't know how it happened. It's a mystery to Paul, it was a mystery to me. None of us knew what it was about or whatever. But of course they credited to me or Paul saying, you know, that it was publicity seeking and we did it. It was too far out for us to have thought of it, you know. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a very, I don't know, it was a peculiar thing. I don't know what it was about.
So where did the actual story of this death of a rock god originate from anyway? That may be the biggest mystery of them all. 1965, December 26th. Paul McCartney was involved in a car crash while riding his moped. His front tooth is chipped and his upper lip receives a scar, which can be seen on the music video to Rain. March 4th. Maureen Cleave of the London Evening Standard writes an article entitled, How Does a Beatle Live? John Lennon lives like this, which included the infamous quote, we're more popular than Jesus Christ right now.
This created quite a controversy and a furor in this country, as you are obviously aware.
Do you know that, John? You created it.
Now, would you clarify the remark?
Well, I've clarified it about 800 times, you know. I could have said TV or something else, you know. And that's as clear as it can be. I just use Beatles because I know about them a bit more than TV. I could have said any number of things. Wouldn't have got as much publicity, though.
Cleave's article mentions that Lennon had been reading about religion recently. Author Philip Norman confirms in his book, John Lennon, The Life, that Lennon had been deeply absorbed reading the novel, The Passover Plot, by Hugh J. Sconfield. This book played on the thesis that Jesus Christ planned miracles and faked his own crucifixion, using his disciples as unwitting accomplices to fulfill Old Testament prophecies and bring about a new religion. Robert Whittaker's photo session with the Beatles produces the infamous Butcher cover.
1966, May 30th. The Rain single is released. The song is one of the earliest examples of using backwards vocals in a popular recording.
The fade is me singing backwards with the guitars going backwards. Share this now, if it's near if near if near. I can sing it now.
That's great,
right? So yeah, that was the start. That was a gift of God. That one of Jah.
Jah.
You know, he's the God of marijuana now, right? So Jah gave me that one.
1966, John Lennon bought his own secret island, Derinish Island, located in Clew Bay on the West Irish coast. Perhaps this is somehow the inspiration behind the hidden phone number on the LP cover to Magical Mystery Tour. 1966, November 9th. John Lennon met Yoko Ono at John Dunbar's Indica Gallery. 1967, January 7th. Noted art gallery owner Robert Fraser and his personal assistant Mohammed Hajij met with Paul McCartney, Mick Jagger, Keith Richard and Brian Jones. The group left McCartney's Cavendish Avenue home for Richard's country mansion in Sussex to party. All but Hajij headed to the mansion in Jagger's car. Hajij followed in McCartney's custom black Mini Cooper, bringing along drugs for the gathering. He lost control of the car and crashed into a light pole on the M1. Injured but still able to move, Hajij left the wreck to ditch the drugs before the ambulance and police arrived at the scene. The wreck was reported in February in a Beatles fan publication, with some details left out. Paul alluded to this rumor at a press conference in May 1967. 1967 Faul. Rock journalist Jay Marks and Linda Eastman, the future Mrs. McCartney, attend a party given by three Dutch designers known collectively as The Fool. Jay Marks recalled in an article he wrote later in 1969 that Linda was bemoaning that a chick like her didn't stand much of a chance with bachelor Paul McCartney because of his longtime romance with Jane Asher. Marks recalled that a party guest, who was also a friend of the Beatles, asked him and Linda if they knew that Paul had died the year before. That's just a double who's posing as Paul, so sales aren't hurt by the tragedy. Marks and Eastman were surprised at this revelation. Jane is going to help him out, the guest continued. The man she loves died last November. One day soon she'll announce a breakup. It's just a matter of keeping up appearances until the appropriate time. 1968, July 20th. Jane Asher appeared on BBC's D Time and revealed that she and Paul McCartney were no longer together. I haven't broken it off, but it is broken off. Finished, Jane said. I know it sounds corny, but we still see each other and love each other, but it hasn't worked out. Perhaps we'll be childhood sweethearts and meet again and get married when we're about 70. 1968, Faul. Rolling Stone magazine was approached with the rumor that Paul McCartney had died, but rejects the story. John Lennon told Hunter Davis, official biographer of the Beatles, this when discussing how people take the Beatles' music so seriously. We're a con. We know we're conning them. Because we know people want to be conned. They've given us freedom to con them. Let's stick that in there, we say. That'll start them puzzling. I'm sure all artists do when they realize it's a con. I'll bet Picasso sticks things in. I bet he's been laughing for the last 80 years. 1969, early in the year. Supermodel Twiggy, a friend to the Beatles, sets up a deal for her other friend Terry Knight, who would later be the manager-producer for Grand Funk Railroad, to meet with the Beatles and discuss his recording on the label. Knight is there to witness the growing tension between the members of the Beatles. Knight ends up returning to the States and not signing with Apple. Sympathetic to Paul McCartney of all the Beatles, Knight records a song in support of McCartney. 1969, March 12th. Paul McCartney marries Linda Eastman. May 19th. Capitol Records releases Terry Knight's St. Paul. The lyrics, interestingly enough, were published by McLean Music Limited, a publishing company set up to exclusively publish the words and melodies of John Lennon and Paul McCartney. Knight's song is the one exception in the catalog. Thinking I was free. Did I hear you call or was I? 1969, September 17th. Tim Harper of Drake University in Des Moines, Iowa, writes the earliest published account of the Paul is dead rumor. Is Beatle Paul McCartney dead?
Lately on the campus, there has been much conjecturing on the present state of the Beatle Paul McCartney. An amazing series of photos and lyrics on the group's albums point to a distinct possibility that McCartney may indeed be insane, freaked out.
Harper was told of the rumor, by D'Artagnan Brown, who heard the story himself around the 12th of September from a girl that was at his house with some musicians that crashed there. 1969, Turn Me On Dead Man pamphlet by J. Lancelot Turner is published by Stone Garden Press and receives limited distribution.
And in this booklet, J. Lancelot went through all the clues so far, not including the Abbey Road album, which was not yet issued. And he went through the Beatles songs one by one, combing and looking for clues.
1969, September 19th, John Summer, a student at Ohio Wesleyan University, attends a party with several friends where he first learns about the rumor. 1969, September 23rd, clues hint at possible Beatle death by Barb Olvilden was published in the Northern Star at Illinois University. 1969, October 1st, Apple Records releases Abbey Road in the United States. Capitol Records served as the distributor in the U.S. 1969, October 8th, WOIA-FM, Ann Arbor, Michigan, DJ Larry Monroe takes calls from listeners who talk about the rumor that Paul McCartney had died in a car crash and that clues are planted among several albums. 1969, October 9th, WOIA DJ Jim Curtis, real name Jim Kerr, calls Abbey Road, but forgetting the time difference between the two countries, only reaches a night watchman who dismisses the rumor. Larry Monroe again discusses the rumor with student listeners who call in, and at the peak of the program, a power failure plunged the entire dorm into darkness and spooks the callers and Monroe. 1969, October 10th. After calling into Monroe's show at WOIA, Russ Updike, a friend of Monroe's associate, Country Dan, is killed in a car crash caused by a drunk driver while on his way to the radio station to be a part of the panel discussing the hoax. Monroe, devastated by this accident, refused to play the Beatles on the air or discuss the rumor again for many years after. 1969, October 12th. WKNR DJ Russ Gibb in Detroit, Michigan, gets a phone call from a young man named Tom.
And who do we have here? What's your name?
Tom on the line.
Yeah, hello, Tom. What's going down?
I was
going
to rant with you about McCartney being dead. What is this all about?
You heard that McCartney was dead.
Yeah, that's right.
Tom was Tom Zaski, an Eastern Michigan University student.
He said, yeah, you know, I hear that all the time. He said, but no, have you ever played a number nine, number nine, number nine backwards? And I said, what? He said, no, play the record backwards. At that point, I said, play the record backwards? He said, yeah. He said, get from the White Album, number nine, number nine, number nine. So I get this out, put it on, and I back cue it, which meant you actually turn the turntable with your hand. That's how we used to cue up records in the old days. And clearly comes out, turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man, with an English accent. Well, I freaked, and of course the audience freaked. Within minutes, that phone was lit up. Within about half an hour, people were calling with other clues. We were playing records backwards, forwards, and people were coming in with all kinds of stories.
1969, October 14th, Michigan Daily, a college newspaper, publishes student Fred Labor's Abbey Road tongue-in-cheek review, which delves into the story behind Paul McCartney's supposed demise. McCartney dead, new evidence brought to light.
They asked me to review Abbey Road, which was the current Beatle album. So I decided I didn't want to just write a review about, you know, this is Paul does this song and George does this song, et cetera, like all reviews go. So I decided to make it work symbolically on a religious level. So, and also there were a lot of rumors going around that Paul was dead, so, you know, I just started putting all those clues together.
Labor would supply some details that become part of the legend, such as the information that Paul was replaced with an orphaned lookalike named William Campbell. 1969, October 15. John Summer has his thesis about the rumor published in some newspapers. 1969, October 19th. WKNR airs the program The Beatle Plot with Russ Gibb, Dan Carlisle, and John Small. Eric Clapton, John Lennon, and the astrologer Cleo are all interviewed for the show.
The subject is Paul McCartney. The theme is symbolism. The thesis is death.
If there was any kind of coincidental connection between any of these things, which it sounds as though there is, you know, I must admit I'm as convinced as anybody could be.
John Lennon, there is no doubt in your mind about the fate of Paul McCartney.
No, it's a joke, isn't it? I mean, Paul isn't dead, you know, and if he was, we would have told you, you know. We'd be the first to know.
Well, how did the rumors affect both of you at this point?
It's a joke to us. No, it's just a joke. Just insanity, but it's great plug for Abbey Road.
Derek Taylor.
Yeah, sure.
How are you, sir?
I'm fine. Now, listen, I'll tell you, McCartney is alive. To do to prove he's alive, apart from be alive.
I think if you could, we could talk to Paul, and if he could dispel it, that would be the greatest thing that could happen around this town.
Well, it'd certainly be great to have a tape of Paul saying he's not dead, but it gets very grotesque. If people don't believe that the man who married Linda, or that the man who sang Maxwell's Silver Hammer, or the man who was on the photograph on the Abbey Road cover is Paul, who's going to believe that his voice on the air is Paul?
What about the Paul spelled out on the Sgt. Pepper's album, the guitar in flowers?
That's apparently the left-handed guitar there.
Yes.
On the grave.
Yes, it is a grave.
Listen, don't worry about that question. It's all coincidence. Paul McCartney isn't dead, and the only proof we have that he's alive at this point is that he is. You don't have to do any more than that to prove you're alive, except be alive.
If you may, let me tell you how I, Lou Yeager, got involved with this and where it went to. It was October of 1969, and a friend of mine woke me up one night, called me on the phone and said, "Hey, I had this terrible dream that the Beatle, Paul McCartney, was dead." Well, I indicated to the person that perhaps a person should go back to sleep. It was 3 o'clock in the morning, and we'll talk about it in the morning. Well, that didn't do it, because that person was very insistent, and it told me that I had to get out of bed and start looking at some of these clues. Well, I did, or else I was never going to get any sleep anyways. And we kind of got to number 9, and by accident, I had turned number 9 backwards, which was Revolution number 9 from the Double White album. And I heard, "Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man." Well, that was it. My appetite for clues became insatiable. And a committee was formed at Hofstra University in Hempstead, New York. And we began to tear the albums apart. 3 days later from this phone call, we got on a talk show on one of the leading talk radio stations in New York, and I said, "Ladies and gentlemen of New York, Paul McCartney is dead." And that's when it all blew apart, because the number one rock and roll station had heard this, and a disc jockey on the air started turning the records backwards on that station. That station was the flagship station for ABC. The station we're talking about is WABC. And the jock we're talking about is Ropey Young.
1969, October 21st.
Ropey Young in New York. WABC! It is 22 before the hour at 1 o'clock, WABC chime time. I just got a call from Georgia. Now, this doesn't mean a heck of a lot, except for the fact that the other night I got a call from Indiana. And the whole thing is about one thing. The fact that there's something very strange about the Beatle Paul. The fact that the Beatle Paul may be dead. In Indiana University, for instance, at Bloomington, there are 30 students working on a research project indicating that the Beatle Paul might be dead. There's something very strange going on. It may be a promotion stunt, or it may be the real thing, or it may be the Beatles trying to tell us something. I don't know what it is, but I do know this. There is something there.
1969, October 22nd.
It's our pleasure to report that Beatle Paul McCartney is alive and well, and as he puts it, unconcerned about the rumors of his death. Apparently the rumors started when this picture appeared on the latest Beatle album showing Paul in his bare feet. To some, that is a death symbol. But the photographer who snapped the picture explained simply, it was just a very hot day.
WMCA, New York. Alex Bennett talks with Paul's barber, Leslie Cavendish.
I guess we're going to extremes to try and find out
for the American public if the real Paul McCartney's alive. What do you think of these rumors?
I think they're ridiculous. Paul McCartney is alive and well. I saw him 2 weeks ago, and I cut his hair, and it's the same Paul McCartney I've been cutting for 3.5 years. They're just ordinary people. You know, everyone thinks because they're the Beatles, they've got to be something different, and everybody starts. Everything they say, people try to analyze. They're real four guys in Liverpool who are just normal, natural guys.
Thomas Nutter is a tailor, and I can think of no one else who has... can tell you whether it's the same Paul McCartney or not, I guess. Huh? You fit him for clothes.
Yeah, well, it's that he came in on Wednesday, we fitted him, and so he's definitely alive. Really, that's all I can say.
That is the same body you've been fitting for years.
Yeah, yeah, without a doubt.
Tell me, have you heard about the rumors about Paul, haven't you?
Oh, it's a load of old rubbish. It's ridiculous. I know how anyone... You know, we were discussing
what, you've heard the rumors, haven't you? You should try not to look at me when she doesn't want to talk to her. Haven't you heard him?
No, it's stupid, isn't it?
It's
we've been seeing him every day for years and years. I mean, we've noticed if he's changed or if anything happened.
You photographed the album cover Abbey Road, right?
Yes, right.
Why the bare feet? Why, everybody looks at that Volkswagen and says it's out of place, and the license number has some significance.
I agree about the car being out of place. We tried to move it. We had a policeman directing traffic, and the Volkswagen had been parked there apparently for about 2 weeks. Somebody had gone off and left it there when he went on holiday. I thought the policeman would have sets of keys for any car, you know, so we tried to get it moved. But they said they wouldn't be able to do that unless it was causing a traffic offence, which it wasn't.
What about the bare feet?
The bare feet is easier. It was just a very, very hot day. And Paul just did his thing and took his shoes off and left him lying on the sidewalk and picked him up when the photographic session was over.
Is there anything hidden? Did they plan anything to be hidden? Was there any subtlety that was supposed to be put in, that was put in there that we're all supposed to look for?
The only subtlety which was put in by anybody was done by the magic people in the darkroom.
We've been framed. We've been told he's been dead for 2 years. So whoever we produce is going to have to be fingerprinted and voice taped and blood tested, and that'll be a lot of because that would be contributing to the rumor.
Neil Aspinall is a gentleman who has been with the Beatles since before Love Me Do and She Loves You and I Want to Hold Your Hand.
Somebody was dead, you say it. You don't go to into all this rubbish that's going on, you know.
Was it Paul as the walrus?
Do you mean in those costumes?
Yeah.
No, it's John.
It's John as the walrus?
Yes. Yes. You see, now this is the thing they've all been saying, is that Paul was the walrus, and walrus is a word that means corpse in Greek.
Does it?
And let's go on to the double album, the white-covered album. On the collage inside, on the back of which are the lyrics, people are saying that passport photo is not Paul, but the guy who has replaced him, and that was a picture of a William Campbell, who was the winner of the look-alike contest. Now, you probably know what that photo is. What is that
photo? I don't know which photograph you're talking about. Which passport photo?
It's a picture of somebody who looks very much like Paul with a mustache. It looks like a passport photo.
With glasses on?
Yes.
With their glasses on. It's a funny story. We were in Sweden years and years ago. And four of us went down into the restaurant to eat, and Paul stayed upstairs, you know. And then he came into the restaurant, and he didn't come in. This photographer came in saying, Parisi, take your picture, take your picture. And he had a moustache and glasses, and his hair swept back. And he went around the whole restaurant, like laying on the floor and doing angle shots of people, giving them this like plastic card, and then he'd go to another table, take some more, then go and take the card off the people he'd just given, because they only had one card. And give it to someone. And suddenly we realised that it was Paul doing it all. And he'd gone upstairs, he'd put this moustache on, glasses, swept his hair back, and none of us recognised him. And it was hilarious, you know, he just had a scream, you know. And then he went back upstairs, and he came to, and there was a couple of people at our table too, you know, besides us, who didn't recognise him, you know. And they kept saying, where's Paul? And we were saying, I don't know, you know. And then this photographer left the room, it was, you know, Paul, and went back upstairs, combed his hair down, took the glasses off and moustache, and came and sat down. And then these people that were with us were just telling him about this mad photographer that had just been around, you know. It was a scream, and it was, somebody took a picture of him in that disguise. You know, this is only about 19 or something, you know, and he's just found that picture and used it on the collage. But it isn't somebody else, you know.
What could you say to dispel these rumors that have started in the United States?
I can't say anything, you know. People are going to believe it, they're going to believe it. I can only say it's not true.
Not one bit of it?
No, not one bit of it.
It's the same McCartney you've always known.
Yeah.
Well, here are four guys, four human beings, who have managed to almost become a spiritual thing to a lot of people around the world.
1969, October 23rd. ABC newscast Gregory Jackson looks at clues.
As any parent can testify, the lifestyle of the Beatles has always been somewhat different. And if you believe current rumor, their style of revealing Paul McCartney's alleged death is being carried out with singular taste. Like reading tea leaves, all clues are in the album. Here in New York, the city's largest record store said today that the Beatles' latest album cost about $2 more than the past albums. And he said they haven't been selling very well, at least up to now, before the rumors started.
1969, October 24th.
A photo was transmitted to U.S. newspapers. It showed Paul McCartney, his wife and child, at Glasgow Airport, or so the caption said. Other than that, no other story accompanied that photograph.
Well, there he is. He walks, he talks, he sings. Paul McCartney of the Beatles. He finally got in front of a camera in Glasgow today to put an end to the speculation that he is no longer among the living. He is. And now the whole world has been apprised of that fact.
Despite all rumors and reports to the contrary, Paul McCartney of the Beatles is alive and walking around, if a little irritated that people keep saying he is dead.
1969, October 29th. MGM issued The Ballad of Paul by the Mystery Tour.
Has Paul McCartney left this world? Has he taken his last breath? Have John and George and Ringo told us of his death? Never made the paper, you didn't read it in the news, but it's right there for you to find in several hidden clues.
1969, October 30th, RCA issued So Long Paul by Werbley Finster, a.k.a. Jose Feliciano.
The news concerned itself with a young man everybody knows, and they said that he went running, taking off his clothes. And I said, so long, Paul, we hate to see you go. So long, Paul, after making all that dough. So long, Paul, we hate to see you go.
Fall. Silver Fox Records releases Brother Paul by Billy Shears and the All-Americans, which was commissioned by WTIX Radio in New Orleans for its radio coverage of the hoax.
True, are
countrywide publications publishes Paul McCartney Dead, The Great Hoax. Viking Records releases We're All Paul Bearers by Zacharias and the Tree People. BBC interview, Beatle producer George Martin had this to say on the matter.
A lot of things added up. People, in fact, I started getting letters from people outlining how obvious it was that Paul was dead. You know, I began to believe it myself.
1969, November. Cream magazine, volume 2, number 6, features an article discussing the hoax. The Paul McCartney death hoax and how it grew, by Daday Loreen. The article features Russ Gibb, Dan Carlisle, and John Small from WKNR. Polydor Records of Canada releases the LP Very Together, an album consisting of recordings from the Beatles' early days with Tony Sheridan. The LP sports the infamous Candelabra cover. 1969 November, WNEW-FM News Close Up, with Christopher Glenn discusses the rumor. Glenn interviews John Summer.
I don't believe Paul's dead, and I believe that this was intentional, that they wanted the masses to discover these inferences to Paul's death and take it as such and then let the rumor pass over.
Why would they want to do this?
Well, for their own enjoyment. Can't be anything else, really. You know, it can't be publicity because they certainly don't need it. And, you know, how far can you go in the musical field without getting a little bit bored?
Dr. Stanley Milgram of the City University of New York Graduate Center.
The two elements that underlie a rumor are first, ambiguity, and secondly, importance. Whenever you have an event that is ambiguous and yet important, you get rumors developing about it. And I think if you look at the McCartney issue, you'll see that both elements are present. We're not certain whether he's dead or not. The cues that have been provided are at best ambiguous. On the other hand, there's no question as to the emotional importance of a member of the Beatles. I mean, after all, the Beatles are the saviors of this decade.
1969, November 2nd. The New York Times publishes an article by J. Marx entitled No, 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 Paul McCartney is Not Dead. In this article, Marx recounts the night he and Linda Eastman attended the party held by The Fool in 1967. It is obvious by his words that Marx did not actually believe the story of McCartney's untimely demise himself. 1969, November 5th. Variety article published. Rumors of McCartney's death put Buku Life into Abbey Road sales, states the article. The ballyhoo seems to have spurted sales into an all-time peak pace for the British combo. Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, Magical Mystery Tour, and The Beatles, aka The White Album, all resurfaced on Billboard's Top 200 LP chart after all being absent from the list for about a year and a half.
Life magazine had a photo of Paul and his family assuring distraught fans that Paul is still with us.
Linda makes no secret of the fact that the latest rumors have upset them.
You know, I just think it ruins our life, that kind of thing. Because I don't think people realize that for them it's headlines in the newspapers, but everybody starts bothering us. You know, we come out here for a holiday to be left alone.
Thank you.
1969, November 8th. Billboard article, Death Pushes Beatles Sales. WKBWAM Buffalo, New York puts on the radio program Paul McCartney is alive and well, maybe. Jefferson K hosts with guests Dan Neverith, Stan Roberts, and Sandy Beach.
My immediate reaction to the McCartney puzzle was, sure, why not? These guys are capable of almost anything. And if anybody could pull off a massive deception like this, it would be somebody like them. They certainly had the necessary funds, they had secluded mansions, and to all appearances, they had the minds to find a certain amount of satisfaction from hatching a plot like this. But then, after spending many hours, too many hours, sifting, sorting, and listening, and arguing, and we did do some arguing, I felt that this surely could not be this thing that everybody felt, this feeling that McCartney was dead. I didn't feel that it could be, but I did feel that the mountains of evidence were far too great in volume alone to be just a series of coincidences. So I think that the Beatles, in the past few years, have very consciously laid the groundwork for the event that we're exploring tonight. And incidentally, the sale of their old albums has increased tremendously. You just try to buy a copy of Sgt. Pepper at the corner record store. I honestly feel that right now they're laughing. I really do. I think they're laughing. But I think it's a pretty sick laugh.
George Martin, arranger, producer for the Beatles.
He's alive and well and with his wife and their two children and the dog, Martha. Ringo and Paul and their wives went to see Mary Hopkin at the Savoy. Well, there were numerous press people there. His way of life continues normally. He goes to see his father. He goes to soccer matches. He does the McCartney things. He is McCartney.
Mike McGear, Paul's brother.
Actually, yes, he died in an earthquake in Mexico in 1917. Now, actually, it's my baby that is doubling for him. My little baby girl will be the fourth Beatle soon.
Paul McCartney.
I was barefooted because it was a nice day. And if it's a nice day, I don't like wearing shoes. I wore a black carnation on Magical Mystery Tour, and the other three wore red. The reason for that is that they didn't have any more red ones. And I just got handed a black one, so I stuck that in my buttonhole, you know.
If the conclusion you reach is that I'm dead, then you're wrong, because I'm alive and living in Scotland.
The Mike Douglas Show. McCartney's younger brother, Mike McGear, appears on the show with his comedy group, The Scaffold.
What do you think? You've heard all the clues. Is your brother, Paul McCartney, alive?
No, I think he's dead all right.
There's the proof.
Yeah,
there's
the proof, yeah.
When was the last time you saw your brother?
The last time?
Yes.
It was his funeral, I think.
1969, November 29th. Rolling Stone magazine reports Capitol Records Vice President of National Merchandising, Rocco Catena, as claiming, "This is going to be the biggest month in history in terms of Beatles sales. Rumble on McCartney's death creating nothing but extra sales in all my markets." It is also reported that New York had significant pickup sales of all Beatles catalog albums and that the action in Dallas was tremendous. 1969, November 30th. Paul McCartney, the complete story told for the first and last time. An RKO syndicated television special with F. Lee Bailey aired on WOR-TV in New York. A mock trial is put on with Bailey questioning such witnesses as Russ Gibb, Fred LeBour, the Beatles manager Alan Klein, and Paul McCartney's younger brother Mike McGear. After the program was broadcast, all videotapes of the show disappeared and remain lost to this day. Only audio survived thanks to a Beatles fan who recorded the show off his television as it aired that night.
May we have your name, sir?
My name is Doc Siegel.
And what is your occupation?
I'm a recording engineer for Gold Star Studios in Hollywood.
Siegel, have you heard the recordings that we just played through the other witness?
Oh, yes.
And have you sufficient technical experience to give us any opinion as to the likelihood that these could have been accidentally implanted?
Well, I think that my experience is quite extensive, both in recording and TV fields, audio-wise. And It's my considered opinion that they could not have been accidental.
Mr. Siegel, based on your experience, do you think it likely or even possible that these could be just sounds which, through coincidence, seem to reflect a tragic event or a death?
I would say, offhand, that it is possible for perhaps one or two to be accidental. But in a majority, no. I think that they actually were planted.
Have you ever, in your experience, uncovered accidental implantations like this in recordings?
Accidental? No. Never.
Thank you very much. Sir, may we have your name?
Cannon.
And what is your occupation?
I'm the program director of radio station WKNR.
Have you had occasion since the broadcast on October 12, 1969, to receive any phone calls about the McCartney incident?
Yes, many phone calls. We've made many phone calls ourselves, too, called extensively to England.
Have you received any from people purporting to be connected with the Beatles?
We did on October the 22nd. We received a phone call in the morning about 10 o'clock, our time, from a man who said he was Paul McCartney. We were interested in the symbolism, if there was any, and why they had done certain things. And he said that there was no symbolism, nothing intended. It was very spontaneous.
Denied it all.
Yes, he did. Okay, Paul McCartney says, it's whatever anyone reads into it is what it is. It's, you know, just because you create the sensationalism, why should you make anything of it by broadcasting it? It was your station that created this sensationalism and all that, and he said, rubbish. You gave the initial broadcast, which started it, and fed it with phone calls about me and letters about it. It's just one big drag having to deny it, and I wish you'd stop.
Sir, what is your name?
Peter Asher.
And do you know Paul McCartney, Mr. Asher?
Yes, I do. I've known him well for about 5 years.
Are you the brother of Jane Asher?
Yes, I am.
And was she at one time associated with Paul in some way?
Yes, she was, yes.
How well do you know him? Is he a close friend?
Yes, he's a close friend.
And so you've known a man who calls himself Paul McCartney both before and after November 1966?
Yes, I've known both of them.
You satisfied that he's alive?
Absolutely and completely. There's no doubt whatever that the whole business is fictitious.
Do you think that the Beatles have deliberately put a suggestion of death throughout their songs?
No, I do not. No, I don't.
Do you think all of these things that were pointed out by Mr. Labour are pure coincidence?
I think the clues are a mixture of coincidence. They're a mixture of things that are on the records and if you listen to in a certain way, could be interpreted in this light because of the theory, but I don't think that any of them are clues planted in order to suggest that Paul is dead.
Well, we've been told by a previous witness that the Beatles are a little bit prankish when they put together an album. Isn't that true?
Prankish in the sense that they're light-hearted. They don't prank in the sense of deliberately planning to deceive, no.
Mr. Asher, you claim, of course, that Paul is alive. That may well be so.
I know.
You also claim that the Beatles did not deliberately try to create this myth in order to increase their publicity.
That is what I know to be true, yes.
But it has increased the publicity, hasn't it?
Well, only because all you people have taken it seriously enough to do all this incredible nonsense for an hour.
Yes.
About something that really is just, you know, not true and in Paul's own words, is bloody stupid.
Life magazine, too, is guilty of incredible nonsense, is it not?
Yes, they are indeed.
And Time magazine is guilty of incredible nonsense.
Well, you can't blame them any more than one can blame you because it's news. It's only news because people are stupid enough to want to believe it.
I see. Do you think that it does any good at all for the Beatles to be thus publicized about a very fascinating possibility?
I really don't know. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if you're probably right. Their record sales have probably increased because of this. But that's certainly something that doesn't concern them. They're not about to embark on some ridiculous publicity thing to try and sell more records. They've sold all the records they ever need to sell.
Yes, I understand. You are, as you have put it, a very close friend of Paul McCartney.
I am.
Well, isn't it a fact that even if you thought he was guilty of a little hoax here, that you wouldn't say so?
Oh, well, you mean that I'm lying to continue with
I'm saying that if you suspected that this might be going on, I don't suggest that you're lying, but that you might be inclined to defend him in any event.
That's probably true, yes. If I really thought he was hoaxing, I'd probably back him up, but I swear to you that he is not, and that I know that he's alive, and that he didn't mean any of this to happen, nor did any of them.
So you say that you're not defending him because you don't have to, but if he were guilty of something, you probably would defend him anyway, and that is the basis on which we must judge
credibility. That's a very unfair ending.
That isn't what you intended. Thank you, sir. What is your name, sir?
Sal Iannucci.
Where do you live?
Los Angeles.
By whom are you employed?
Capitol Records.
Is that the same Capitol Record company that publishes the Beatles albums?
That's right.
And in what capacity are you employed?
I'm president of Capitol Records.
What do you know about Paul McCartney being dead?
I've heard a lot of talk, and I've read about it, but I don't believe it.
What has happened to the sale of Beatle records since this wave hit the country, so to speak?
Well, the Abbey record has been selling well, but it was selling well before the actual rumor. It's a very outstanding record, which received a lot of critical acclaim and based on its own merits.
Did you say that you've had no increase in sales, felt no effect from all of this publicity?
Well, on the two records which have been discussed, the Magical Mystery and Sergeant Pepper, we've noticed some increase recently in the number of...
A sharp increase?
It would be substantial over what would be expected, but I'm sure that it's caused in part by the discussion and the conjecture as to whether McCartney...
Would you, as president of Capitol Records, participate in a hoax of this sort in order to increase sales?
No, I don't think we'd engage.
And do you say that none has been perpetrated to your knowledge?
Not to my knowledge.
Your name, sir?
Alan Klein. I'm the president of Abco Industries.
You represent these Beatles we've been talking about?
Yes, we do.
And for how long have you represented them?
About 9 months.
Are you abreast of their business situations, as a rule?
Yes, I am.
Is one of the Beatles that you represent Paul McCartney?
Yes, he is.
And how long have you known him?
It's about January of 1969.
You were never introduced to a man claiming to be Paul McCartney prior to November of 1966?
No, I wasn't.
Did you listen to the tape of the phone call to Mr. Cannon that was supposed to be Paul?
Yes, it did.
And was it?
No.
Do you know who it was?
I think I do.
Can you tell us?
I think it's Tony Bramwell, the promotion man.
Why do you think he would make such a call?
I think that you have a lot of people with no authority who make a lot of statements about the Beatles because they're interested in their own self-adornment.
Do you think the Beatles are in any way profiting, according to your knowledge of their finances, from the intense public interest in these albums?
I would tell you this, that if what you are suggesting and what some other medias are suggesting is the truth, they would be harmed a great deal more. They don't have to stoop to this type of publicity in order to financially reward themselves.
Well, Mr. Klein, absent any commercial interest in the product of all this publicity, do you think they might be up to just some prankery?
I'll tell you, I think that, quite honestly, this type of press is something that really annoys them. They don't really have to do anything special or specific to get press.
You say they're not that kind of guy.
That's right.
All right, then I ask you, why is Paul McCartney not said, okay, look, here's Scotland Yard, they have my prints, here's my fingers, they say I'm the same guy, let's stop the nonsense. He hasn't done that.
If you would guarantee me that every single person who would talk about these particular type of statements would categorically stop and cease and desist, he'd do it.
This then is pretty much the case on the death of Paul McCartney. What does it show? Certainly does not show that he's dead. The inferences drawn by the witnesses because of some very curious statements found and other clues in the record albums that the Beatles produced do not show the fact of death at all. Indeed, it's almost impossible to conceive that a man of the stature of Paul McCartney could be accidentally killed in the public and not learn of it. On the other hand, our technician witness has said very clearly that those sounds, strange as they are and suggestive as they are, could not have gotten there by accident. Are people digging too hard to try to prove something that they only suspect? That's for you to judge. But we might say this. It is perfectly evident that if the Beatles wanted to, they could have, by this time, have completely foreclosed this rumor. And such evidence has not been forthcoming from their end.
1969, late. New Zealand recording artist Shane covers Terry Knight's St. Paul. It becomes a number one hit for Shane in his home country. None other than Paul McCartney sent Shane a congratulatory telegram.
By the sea, thinking I was free. Did I hear you call or was I dreaming then, St. Paul?
The wish to what kind of play on?
I don't believe in Beatles.
November 30th, 1970. George Harrison releases All Things Must Pass. Many of the songs on this triple album set were originally written while the Beatles were still together. On the third disc is a song titled It's Johnny's Birthday, recorded by both Harrison and Ringo Starr. It is said to contain another clue about McCartney's death. Did Paul McCartney actually perish in an automobile accident in the 1960s? Or was this whole thing some macabre marketing ploy? Or a twisted joke spread by the Beatles themselves? even nearly 20 years after the rumor first received widespread attention, George Harrison slipped in a reference to the hoax in his 1987 music video for When We Was Fab. George Harrison asked his former bandmate Paul McCartney to participate in the video for When We Was Fab, along with Ringo Starr. Paul wanted to take part but was unable to work it into his schedule. Paul told Beatle friend Bill Harry and author Andrew Reeve, "You put someone else in the walrus costume and tell everyone it was me. We've always had fun with the walrus thing. We don't leave many false trails, but the walrus has always been one of them."
On the When We Was Fab video, I read in this magazine, Beatle Fan, that Paul McCartney had said in like a London interview that he wanted to play the role of the walrus. And I noticed that as the camera pulls back, there's Ringo, you, and the walrus with the left-hand bass in the shot, just as a guy walks across with John Lennon's Imagine album cover. Now, is that in a reunion? Is Paul in the walrus mask or not?
Well, here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul.
Excellent.
Would it make you like the video anymore if you know it's Paul in there, or could it just be like B.B. King or Alfred Hitchcock? It doesn't really matter, you know. But
doesn't really matter.
But it really is Paul, but he's a bit shy lately.
Or is there another answer, that the whole story was fan-created? Fans seeking to explain the changes and all-too-human foibles they were seeing in their heroes as the reality that the Beatles were splitting apart and would soon be no more. The worshippers tearing down their gods in search of answers and an explanation for what it was all about.
We can either write a song with just simple meaning or maybe a great meaning, but whatever the meaning is when we record the song, it always has a greater meaning or more meanings by the time the listener puts his meaning onto it.
People just take our music and, you know, in a line, and we just sort of say, yeah, she was just 17. And they read everything into that, you know. She was a 17-year-old nymphomaniac working on the streets of Broadway. But, you know, what we meant is she's just 17. But it might mean all the other as well. I don't know, you know. I've no idea if there's any Aeolian cadences and, you know, miasmic climaxes and all of that. I mean, we're the last people to know about our songs, because the pop world's never heard the pop world as such, because we can't, you know. It's like if you look at a snapshot of yourself, you're looking at what tie you were wearing or whether you were looking nice in the snapshot, you know. But anyone else would just take the snapshot and say, oh, that's good, that's a snapshot of Tony. That's really just always think of ourselves as just happy little songwriters, just little rockers, you know, just playing in a rock group. But it gets more important than that.
One thing is certain, even if Paul McCartney did not die all those years ago, and that is that the rumor itself continues to live on.
Those weeks was right when they said you was dead.
Well, I'd rather see you dead. They might as well dead,
as her love is dead.
I know what it's like to be dead.
Some are dead and some are living.
Died in the church and was buried along with Father Mackenzie, wiping the dirt from his hands as he walks from the grave. No one was saved.
Nothing to do to save his life.
Clang, clang, Maxwell silver hammer made sure that he was dead.
On a gag, if I ain't dead already. Woo!
Oh, well, you know, I nearly fell down. And
will she still believe it when he's dead?
It's far too late when they pass away.
Now my advice for those who die, declare the pennies on your eyes.
For boy, when you're dead, you don't take nothing with you but your soul.
It is not dying. It is not dying.